Hi everyone. So before we get started, I just wanted to go over a bit of general housekeeping. So the session is being recorded. You'll get a link to the slides and the recording afterwards, and the recording will also be on the webinar page on the ASA website. We also have a Q&A box. So we'll have plenty of time for questions at the end. But if anything comes to mind as we're going through the presentation, feel free to pop them in the chat box and I'll get to them at the end. And also, if you don't mind staying on for a few minutes at the end, we'll go through the feedback form. Okay, so let's get going then. Hello again. Yep, so welcome to our webinar on navigating alcohol alternatives in advertising. My name's Becky. I'm a member of the regulatory policy team. Our team is responsible for writing and maintaining the CAP and BCAP codes. So, as most of you, I'm sure, already know, the new alcohol alternative rules and guidance came into force in May earlier this year after a 6-month implementation period. And before then, they went through a full consultation process. With the build up to the festive season and with the usual ads showing people celebrating and raising a glass or two beginning to fill our screens, we felt it was a prime opportunity to go through the new rules and guidance and what provisions they include. So, but as a bit of background on why these rules and guidance were introduced, increasing popularity of alcohol alternatives led to CAP and BCAP deciding that these kinds of products should be subject to specific regulations to ensure that they're marketed responsibly, especially considering their adult audience and how closely they resemble alcoholic drinks. Before the alcohol alternative rules, drinks below 0.5% ABV weren't actually subject to the alcohol rules. But references to alcohol in such ads would be assessed under the general social responsibility rules or under the full alcohol code rules if they promoted alcoholic products. Because of the extremely low alcoholic strength of alcohol alternative products, they are virtually incapable of intoxicating consumers, so their risk profile is significantly reduced. And CAP and BCAP therefore felt it would be overly restrictive to bring all ads for such products under the scope of the alcohol sections of the codes. And so our brand new code rules were born. So as many of the rules depend on the context and the content of an ad, they are accompanied by formal guidance explaining how the rules should be interpreted and applied. So we'll be going through both in a little bit more detail today. I should say, usually in our webinars, we would take you through various case studies of decisions made on ads by the ASA Council. But for today, because the rules are just so new, we unfortunately don't have any precedent on them yet, and we sadly don't have any particular visuals or ads to show you. But I'm going to try and do my best to paint you a word picture as we go through and hopefully make things a little bit clearer. So, without further ado, what are we actually going to be covering today? So, I'm going to take you through what alcohol alternatives actually are, and we'll go through what is likely to be captured by the alcohol alternatives rules. I'm going to cover off the new rules themselves, so they relate to the content of ads as well as their targeting and scheduling. So, we'll talk about all of those in a bit more detail. And then I'll go over the sections of the guidance that expand on what the rules themselves say. So the main sections we'll cover are cross promotion and brand sharing, ABV statements, and finally, unsafe circumstances and consumption habits. So let's kick things off today by looking at the scope of the rules and what alcohol alternatives actually are. So first and foremost, for the purposes of the CAP and BCAP codes, alcohol alternative drinks are those at or under 0.5% ABV. Now, CAP and BCAP understand that there is no statutory definition of alcohol alternatives, and the ABV threshold of 0.5% to define alcohol alternatives was chosen after extensive consideration. So, drinks at or below 0.5% ABV are excluded from the definition of alcoholic in the advertising codes. This reflects various external factors, including the way in which the Licensing Act treats drinks of this strength. And the alcohol alternatives market, broadly speaking, uses terms like alcohol-free, zero alcohol, or non-alcoholic to describe drinks at or below 0.5%. So CAP and BCAP considered that this was a reasonable and proportionate level at which to set the baseline for ABV for the ABV of alcohol alternatives. So beyond the product's ABV, an ad is likely to be under if an ad is likely to be understood by the audience as an ad for an alternative to alcohol, then those new code rules will apply. Now, what kind of factors might contribute to the interpretation that an ad is for an alcohol alternative product? Well, using terms like non-alcoholic or alcohol-free and including statements of an ABV at or below 0.5% will almost always suggest that it's an alcohol alternative, because it makes a deliberate comparison with alcohol. Shared branding with an existing alcoholic drink would likely suggest that it's an alternative to that alcoholic drink. Obviously, referring to consuming the product instead of alcohol would be a factor. Showing the product being consumed in a setting where alcohol sale or consumption is predominant, for example, a bar, a pub or club, etc., that would likely suggest that the product is an alternative to alcohol. And presenting this product in a style associated with alcohol, such as traditionally shaped bottles, like in a sparkling wine bottle, dressed or garnished drinks similar to cocktails, or even using imagery reminiscent of alcoholic drinks, so like corkscrews or cocktail shakers. Again, they would suggest a comparison with alcohol, leading consumers to understand the product to be an alternative to alcohol. So that's not an exhaustive list, but it hopefully gives you a bit more of an idea of what kind of things would contribute to an ad being interpreted as being for an alcohol alternative product. It is also worth noting, it's unlikely that the use of descriptors like soft drink would be enough to mitigate the interpretation that an ad is for an alcohol alternative if the overwhelming message suggests it's an alternative to alcohol. So basically, describing something as a soft drink when everything else points to the ad being for an alcohol alternative is unlikely to prevent the alcohol alternative rules from applying. So there is a specific and limited carve out relating to fermented drinks, such as kombucha. These kind of products are often marketed as soft drinks, but they may contain trace amounts of alcohol. Advertisers are always encouraged to provide potentially material information, and as some consumers don't want to drink even trace amounts of alcohol, advertisers may want to include explanations such as alcohol-free or perhaps a statement of the product's ABV. So this won't automatically cause these products to be subject to the alcohol alternative rules, but these kinds of statements shouldn't be a predominant feature in the ad. They should be more clarificatory. So ABV statements shouldn't be accompanied by preference claims, suggesting the absence of alcohol is a reason to purchase the product, and statements should be less prominent than other elements of the ad. On the other hand, some fermented drinks are presented as alternatives to alcohol, for instance, in bottles similar to sparkling wine, or with the addition of statements about how the product is preferable because of its non-alcoholic nature. In these instances, the alcohol alternative rules are likely to apply. I should also highlight here that many names of alcoholic spirits or drinks with specific styles or geographical indicators, such as champagne, for example, are restricted in use by legislation. So in these instances, advertisers are advised to seek their own legal advice if they want to make reference to products subject to legislative restrictions. So before I go on to the next section, which talks about the rules themselves, I'm going to keep you on your toes and I'm going to do a little pop quiz on what we've covered so far. So you should have a question come up on your screen soon. Go. Hopefully, you can all see that. So, the question is, how are alcohol alternatives defined under the advertising code? Is it drinks at or under 0.5% ABV, drinks above 0.5% ABV but at or below 1.2% ABV, or is it drinks above 0.5% ABV? I'll give you a couple more seconds to answer that. Brilliant. Fantastic. You're all geniuses. Everyone got that one right. So yeah, so non-alcoholic drinks for the purposes of the CAP and BCAP codes are those at or under 0.5% ABV. So for reference, low alcohol drinks are defined in the codes as those containing more than 0.5% ABV and up to 1.2% ABV. And the full alcohol rules apply to all drinks with a strength above 0.5% ABV. So we have another question, which should hopefully come up on your screen soon. There we go. So, what factors are likely to contribute to an ad being interpreted as an ad for an alcohol alternative product? Is it the inclusion of terms such as non-alcoholic along with an ABV statement? Is it shared branding with an existing alcoholic brand? Presenting the product in a style associated with alcohol, such as similar glassware, or is it all of the above? Give you a few more seconds on that one. Okay, we've got some, the majority of people went for all of the above, and that's the right answer. So those are just some of the factors that might contribute to consumers understanding an ad to be for an alcohol alternative. Again, that list isn't exhaustive, and there are a number of other things that could add to consumers' interpretation. So you'd be pleased to know that's it for questions for now. So we're going to move on to the next slide. I think. Is it working? Bear with. Sorry. Only been doing this sort of thing for 4 years now. Still not quite used to all the tech. Okay, so now we're going to take a look at the rules themselves and what provisions they include. So, as a bit of a top line overview, I sh first should point out that the targeting and scheduling restrictions applied to alcohol alternative marketing are the same as the full alcohol rules. So, they can't be directed at or likely to appeal to under 18s. So, I will go into a bit more detail in a minute. But another key point in the new rules is that ABV statements should be reasonably prominent in ads for alcohol alternatives. And it's also important that ads for alcohol alternative products shouldn't disparage sobriety or encourage or condone problem drinking. Now, looking at the rules relating to the content of alcohol alternative ads in a little bit more detail. So, any depictions or references to alcoholic products must comply with the rules relating to the responsible portrayal of alcohol consumption. So this wouldn't automatically apply to references or depictions of a shared brand name, as long as the main effect of the ad is to promote the alcohol alternative. So I'll talk a little bit more about cross promotion and shared branding in a bit when we look in a bit more detail about what the guidance covers. As I mentioned before, ads should include a prominent statement of a product's ABV. So ads for alcohol alternatives aren't prohibited from making a feature of their ABV or making preference claims on this basis, unlike the majority of alcohol advertising. And similarly, alcohol alternative ads aren't prohibited from depicting circumstances where the consumption of an alcoholic drink would be inappropriate or unsafe, such as driving, for example. But again, it must be clear that the product is not alcoholic. So products can resemble an alcoholic drink. But the ad again does need to make explicitly clear that the product featured is an alcohol alternative. And finally, on the content rules front, ads for alcohol alternative products must not present such products as a way to increase alcohol consumption beyond reasonable levels, and they shouldn't include content disparaging sobriety or condoning or encouraging heavy or problem drinking. So again, we will sort of talk about these provisions in a little bit more detail and how they might be interpreted a little later on when we go through the guidance. So as I said, the targeting and scheduling restrictions mirror those already in place for alcoholic products. So that means for non-broadcast and radio ads, they should not appeal particularly to under 18s. And TV ads should not appeal strongly to under 18s. So So ads shouldn't be directed at or targeted at under 18s, and the 25% audience rules apply. So for reference, that rule suggests that no medium should be used to advertise the products if more than 25% of the audience is under 18 years of age. And people shown drinking or playing a significant role in ads must not seem to be or be under 25. So by significant role, that means that they can be shown in ads for example, in the context of family celebrations, but they must be obviously not drinking, and they should be sort of an incidental role, so not playing a significant part in the ad. Also, to be aware, the scheduling rules have been amended to prevent alcohol alternative products from being shown adjacent to programmes commissioned for, principally directed at, or likely to appeal particularly to audiences below the age of 18. Okay, so before we move on, you might have guessed, it's time for another quiz break on what we've just discussed. So hopefully you should have the next question coming up on your screen soon. Here we are. So we've got a true or false statement here. So the targeting rules for alcohol alternative products reflect those that apply to fully alcoholic drinks. Is that true or is that false? Give you a few seconds to answer that one. There we go. So that is true. So both the full alcohol rules and the alcohol alternative rules require advertisers to not direct or target their ads at under 18s. So they must not appeal to under 18s, and they shouldn't feature in a significant role anyone who is or appears to be under 25 years old. So full alcohol and alcohol alternative rules are both the same for targeting and scheduling. So we should come on to the next question now. Hopefully that will be up on your screen in a second. Here we are. So for this one, I'm going to need you to finish this sentence. Ads for alcohol alternative products must not make a feature of their ABV, resemble an alcoholic drink, or disparage or encourage heavy drinking. Hopefully, all the answers are in soon. Here we go. So the answer is three: disparage sobriety or encourage heavy drinking. So ads for alcohol alternatives are required to include a prominent statement of the product's ABV, and they are allowed to make a feature of them or include preference claims on this basis. And alcohol alternative products can absolutely resemble an alcoholic drink, but the ad would need to make explicitly clear that the product featured is an alcohol alternative. Well done on those questions. You'll be glad to know I'm going to give you a bit of a break from them for a little bit. All right, so now we're going to take a look at what the guidance covers. So first up, we have cross promotion and shared branding. So with regards to retailer or brand websites, the guidance makes clear that pages for individual products or alcohol alternative ranges wouldn't automatically be considered cross promotional, even when they appear on websites that also sell alcoholic drinks. So the individual pages should make clear that the product is an alcohol alternative, and they shouldn't direct consumers to an alcoholic product. So, for example, they shouldn't say something like, if you like our zero alcohol drink, try the original. If they did, it would be considered a promotion of the alcoholic product, and the full alcohol rules would then apply. So it's worth noting that automatically populated lists of products, such as customers' previously viewed products that include alcoholic drinks, or dynamic lists of popular products, also wouldn't immediately be viewed as cross-promotional. Neither would links and references to alcoholic products that are part of the site's architecture. So That might include images appearing on the website header that would be displayed on all pages of the website, for example. So, shared branding. So, a fair few alcohol alternatives may be marketed under the umbrella of an existing alcohol brand, as a non-alcoholic version of a popular alcoholic drink. So this is certainly an area that has raised a lot of questions from advertisers, particularly during the consultation process. So some respondents to the consultation felt that shared branding with an existing alcohol product was inherently cross-promotional and could re represent stealth marketing. But CAP and BCAP are aware that shared branding can play a key role in encouraging existing consumers to try an alcohol alternative, therefore reducing their overall consumption. And the risk of alcohol alternative advertising increasing exposure or directing consumers towards alcohol brands, which there is a lack of evidence for anyway, is mitigated by the fact that alcohol alternative ads are subject to the same targeting and media restrictions as alcoholic products. So they cannot appear in spaces and contexts where alcohol advertising is currently prohibited. So therefore, these products won't inherently be treated as cross-promotional, but advertisers should take care. So in terms of the content of the ad, marketers should make sure that the focus is always on the alcohol alternative rather than the brand itself. So let's say the brand name was prominently shown by itself in an ad, but it wasn't being used in the context of the specific alcohol alternative product name. So in that instance, it would likely be seen as promoting the brand as a whole, consequently having the effect of advertising alcoholic drinks, and therefore the full alcohol rules would apply. So the same thinking would also apply for logos or slogans that are easily recognizable as being linked to an established alcohol brand. So unless the logo or slogan had been adapted specifically for the alcohol alternative product, say by changing the color or the appearance of a logo or altering the wording of a slogan, they would be seen as promoting the overall brand, again, having the effect of advertising alcoholic drinks and would then be subject to the full alcohol rules. So it's worth knowing that promoting the parent brand as a whole, including alcohol alternative products alongside alcoholic drinks from the range, is permitted, but those ads will be subject to the rules relating to alcoholic drinks rather than the rules relating to alcohol alternative products. Okay, so some ads for alcohol alternative products, whether by accident or design, might have the effect of promoting alcoholic drinks, such as having shared branding with an existing alcoholic drink, or even by the use of alcohol-related imagery, such as similar packaging, like a six-pack of beer, glassware, like a champagne flute, for example, or serving styles, like a garnished glass that you might expect for a cocktail. So, if these ads don't make the alcohol-free nature of the product clear, they would be considered to have the effect of promoting alcoholic drinks. So they would need to comply with the full alcohol rules. Ads can refer broadly to alcoholic drinks without featuring any specific brands to suggest that consumers decrease their alcohol intake by switching to an alternative. And this won't automatically be subject to the full alcohol rules, especially if it doesn't include imagery related to drinking alcohol. But any broad references to alcohol, though, shouldn't disparage sobriety or condone irresponsible drinking. So I'll talk a little bit more about excessive or irresponsible consumption a little bit later on. So comparison to existing brands or established alcoholic drinks like a spirit or perhaps an IPA, that can play an important role in encouraging consumers to lower their overall alcohol consumption by switching to an alternative. But advertisers should take care with comparative claims that ultimately promote a parent alcohol brand or established alcoholic drink, as these again would be subject to the full alcohol rules. So if an ad discusses the production, development, or history of an alcohol alternative, marketers should again take care to avoid promoting the original alcoholic drink. Now, before we move on to the next section of what the guidance covers, I'm going to do another little knowledge check. So let's have another little quiz break and really get those brains working. You will have another question popping up on your screens in a second. And we have another true or false question. So, individual product pages for alcohol alternative products on websites that also sell alcoholic drinks would automatically be considered as cross-promotional. Is that true or is that false? Have a few seconds on that one. The wording there might have caught a couple of you out. So it is false. So as long as it's clear that the product is an alcohol alternative and the page doesn't feature alcoholic drinks or specifically direct consumers to them, they won't automatically be considered as cross-promotional, and the full alcohol rules won't automatically apply. So we're going to have another question now. We've got three questions in this round. So this is your second one. So, how can marketers take care to avoid cross-promotion when advertising alcohol alternatives under the umbrella of an existing alcohol brand? Should they only use slogans or logos synonymous with the established alcohol brand? Should they focus on the alcohol alternative rather than the brand themselves? Or should they show the alcohol alternative product alongside alcoholic drinks from the range? I have a few seconds to answer that one. Very good. So the answer is two, focus on the alcohol alternative rather than the brand itself. So, using recognizable logos and slogans that haven't been adapted to relate specifically to the alcohol alternative are likely to be seen as promoting the brand as a whole, therefore having the effect of promoting alcoholic drinks, and then the full alcohol rules would then apply. And similarly, showing an alcohol product alongside alcohol alternative drinks from the same range would be subject to the full alcohol rules. We've got one final question for this bit. Really making you work this morning. So for this one, I'm going to need you to finish this sentence again. So ads for alcohol alternatives can refer broadly to alcoholic drinks to promote a parent alcohol brand or established alcohol drink, to encourage consumers to drink alcoholic drinks excessively, or to suggest that consumers decrease their alcohol intake by switching to an alternative. Let's see what everyone thinks they should do for this one. Brilliant. So yeah, so the answer is number three. So ads referring broadly to alcoholic drinks for the sole purpose of suggesting that consumers switch to an alternative to decrease their alcohol intake are unlikely to be subject to the full alcohol rules, particularly if that reference isn't accompanied by imagery related to drinking alcohol. Any references to alcohol in ads for alcohol alternatives shouldn't condone or encourage irresponsible drinking. And claims which have the effect of promoting the parent alcohol brand or established alcoholic drink would be subject to the rules relating to alcoholic drinks. So brilliant. Now we're done with questions for a minute. Going to move on to the next section. Hopefully, there we go. So yeah, so now we're going to touch on ABV statements. This has been an area where we've received quite a lot of queries about since the new rules came into force. Oops, sorry, hold on, bear with. Okay. So because some consumers don't want to consume drinks with even trace amounts of alcohol, perhaps because there's a risk of physical or emotional harm, and due to descriptors such as alcohol-free or zero alcohol being used for products up to and including 0.5% ABV, the rules and guidance stipulate that the ABV should be stated with reasonable prominence in alcohol alternative ads. So whether the product is 0.5% ABV or it contains no alcohol whatsoever at 0% ABV, the ad should still include the ABV with reasonable prominence. Now, obviously, the term reasonable prominence is quite subjective, And as I said at the start, we unfortunately don't have any precedents to demonstrate to you what the ASA Council would consider to be reasonably prominent. But it is unlikely that displaying the ABV in footnotes, on-screen text, or the equivalent for audio ads would be sufficiently prominent. So, alcohol alternative ads can make a feature of their ABV or lack of it. And they can suggest that the product is preferable because of it, which isn't the case for the majority of alcohol advertising. So, in cases where alcohol alternative products are featured as part of a range in a single ad, and where there's no issue of time or space limitations, ads should include the ABV for each of the specific alcohol alternatives alongside the products featured. But where time and space is limited, advertisers can include a clear and prominent information on the highest and the lowest ABVs in the range. So consumers have clear information on the range of ABVs, and they understand that the lowest ABV quoted doesn't apply to all of the products featured. So hopefully you're all still with me. We're on the home stretch now. I'm going to take you through the last few sections covered by the guidance, and then we'll have time for any questions. So, unsafe scenarios. So that's referring to things like driving. They're not prohibited in alcohol alternative ads. So that's because there's no public policy concerns over the consumption of alcohol alternative products in such circumstances, unlike with alcoholic products. So alcohol alternatives are really useful products for those who are unwilling or unable to drink alcohol, such as designated drivers. So, showing such scenarios isn't prohibited as long as the ad makes sufficiently clear that the product is an alcohol alternative. So, let's say we have an ad for a non-alcoholic beer, it's showing someone drinking in a pub who then drives home. Showing this kind of scenario would likely be acceptable as long as there is absolutely no question that the product the person has consumed does not contain alcohol. So it could include a clear and prominent statement of the product's name and alcohol-free or other similar statements, along with the accompanying ABV information, or it could include statements like for those not drinking or something similar to that. And these are factors that would likely make such ads compliant with the rules. So it should always be clear to consumers that the unsafe scenario is acceptable because the product doesn't contain alcohol. So advertisers should take caution if they're attempting to be ambiguous with that. So whilst the new rules for alcohol alternatives do allow for scenarios in which alcohol consumption would be unsafe because of potential impairment from intoxication, for example, this doesn't include situations where alcohol consumption could present other risks, like in health contexts, and where official guidance therefore advises abstinence. So this is particularly relevant to pregnancy, where there's a shortage of evidence relating to the risks of consuming alcohol alternatives. The chief medical officer's official advice is to avoid alcohol, even at low levels. So the CAP and BCAP guidance therefore reflects that messaging and states that ads for alcohol alternatives must not state or imply such products should be consumed during pregnancy or when trying to conceive. There is, however, an allowance for products at 0.0% ABV to include depictions of pregnancy in their marketing because they contain no alcohol whatsoever. That should be fine, but any depictions or references to pregnancy should ensure that the nature of the product is clear and it shouldn't condone or encourage consumption of alcohol in similar circumstances. Okay, so here we are at our final section. Due to their proximity to alcoholic drinks, ads for alcohol alternatives should be careful not to encourage excessive or otherwise problematic consumption of alcohol. So, this would be most likely to happen when ads refer to heavy or binge drinking or after effects such as severe hangovers and suggesting that these are normal or matter-of-fact drinking styles. So, alcohol consumption in some situations, such as while commuting, or regularly throughout the day and or week, so leading to high consumption overall. They're often linked with problem drinking or alcohol dependence behaviors and would generally be considered inappropriate. Alcohol alternatives aren't prohibited from referring to or showing the product being consumed in such situations, but they should take care not to condone or encourage consumption of alcohol in this manner. So they shouldn't imply that wanting to consume alcohol in these situations is commonplace. Like saying something like, "Finally, you can drink beer all day without feeling guilty." And it's worth noting that if it isn't clear whether a drink being featured in those kinds of situations is alcoholic, that is likely to contribute to the interpretation that the ad is condoning consumption of alcohol in similar circumstances. Now, you might have thought that I'd let you get away without another mini pop quiz, but you'd be wrong. So before I finish up, let's have another super quick knowledge check on what we've just covered. Got three questions in this section, and then your hard work will be done. So first up, we've got another true or false question. So ads for alcohol alternatives are prohibited from depicting the products being consumed before driving. Is that true or is that false? Have a few seconds on that one. Hopefully you're all still with me and I've not put you to sleep. Very good. So yes, that's false. So because there are no public policy concerns over the consumption of alcohol alternatives in circumstances like driving, they aren't prohibited from depicting these scenarios, provided it's clear in the ad that the product is an alcohol alternative. Got another question coming up now. So for this one, when might it be acceptable to include depictions of pregnancy in ads for alcohol alternatives? Is it when the product contains no alcohol whatsoever at 0.0% ABV? Is it when the product contains 0.5% ABV? Or is it always acceptable? Brilliant. So yeah, so it's when the product contains no alcohol whatsoever at 0.0% ABV. So it would be inappropriate for CAP and BCAP to decide whether consumption of alcohol alternatives, even at low levels, is compatible with the Chief Medical Officer's advice to avoid alcohol. So the codes can't permit messaging that contradicts those guidelines. However, as alcohol alternatives at 0.0% ABV, because they contain no alcohol whatsoever, CAP and BCAP considered it proportionate to allow these products to include depictions of pregnancy in their marketing, as long as the nature of the product is clear. Now we're going to have our last question of the session. So, which of these statements is true for alcohol alternatives advertising? They should not condone or encourage excessive consumption of alcohol. They are permitted to show the product being consumed in situations where alcohol consumption would be inappropriate or unacceptable, and they should not imply that wanting to drink alcohol in inappropriate situations is commonplace, or all of the above. Give you a few more seconds on that one. A little bit wordy, that one. Brilliant. Yeah, so it's for all of the above. So ads for alcohol alternatives should not be presented as a way to increase alcohol consumption and should be careful not to encourage excessive or otherwise problematic consumption of alcohol. So, whilst they aren't prohibited from showing the product being consumed in situations which could be linked with problem drinking or alcohol dependence behaviour, for example, first thing in the morning, in many circumstances, they do need to take care not to suggest that wanting to consume alcohol in that manner is commonplace, and they shouldn't encourage alcohol consumption in that manner. Very well done, all of you. So, That's it from me. So now we have some time if anyone has any questions on what we've just gone through. So if you did have any questions, feel free to pop those in the Q&A chat box. I'm going to invite my colleague Lade back to give me a hand with those.
No, we don't have any questions at the moment, but we'll give people some time to pop any questions that they have in the box.
Hopefully everything I've gone through was clear. Obviously, it would have been a lot better if we'd had some examples to be able to show everyone to put things into context. But keep an eye on our rulings and stuff, and I'm sure there'll be some examples coming through next year and stuff, so to help put things into context.
Thanks, Becky. And if anyone found any of the questions tricky and they just want further clarification, any of the answers, feel free to put that in. We've got our first question come through, Becky, which I'll read out to you. Are there any time gating for online advertising that would be similar to alcohol?
Am I right in thinking that that's sort of relating to when ads like what time of day ads would be like, you could put them on, they could be shown. Is that right? Is that what you're sort of
I
looking for?
believe so. Please,
Okay.
yes, they said sorry, yes, time of day.
Oh, okay. So yeah, again, because the targeting and scheduling rules mirror those that apply for alcohol, that's for full alcohol products, that is likely to be the case, yes. So anything you would do for alcohol advertising, you should also do for alcohol alternatives in terms of targeting and time of day.
Okay. Do you have any thoughts on alcohol alternatives that make a feature of functional ingredients, for example, vitamins or CBD?
So for those sorts of products, they would still be subject to our food rules, which is a different section of the codes. So yeah, so that would still be treated the same way that we would approach any other health drink or product, whether they contain alcohol or not. They would still that would the food rules would still apply to that, and they would still need to have substantiation for those sorts of claims.
Thank you. Then, are there any are there certain rules, i.e., alcohol alternatives, that are commonly breached by advertisers?
So we actually, again, because we've not sort of had the precedent on them on the new rules yet, we've not seen any particular sort of trend in any breaches yet. We've not published any rulings, so it's difficult to sort of answer that without the precedent to sort of fall back on. We have had quite a lot of queries about ABV prominence, so I'd say that's probably the thing that advertisers are most sort of concerned with getting right and wanting to make sure that the ABV is prominent. But without any rulings, I unfortunately can't sort of comment on what people haven't been compliant on, because we just don't have the precedent to sort of suggest that yet.
Aren't any questions in the Q&A, but if you do have any further thoughts, please do pop them in. We'll give it a few minutes to see if anyone else wants to ask anything.
And again, yeah, if anything sort of comes up after we finished on the webinar, feel free to drop us an email. We're more than happy to answer any questions you might have that might come to you afterwards.
We've got another question come through. Would an ABV percentage be prominent enough amongst a legal super slash disclaimer on screen? I believe you might have touched on this.
Yeah, so I think again, like anything like on screen text, if it's hidden away in anything, footnotes, that's not going to be it's not going to be prominent enough. It would sort of need to be separate from that.
I hope that answers your question, Peter. Just waiting for some more questions to come through. Otherwise, we won't drag this out longer than it needs to be. We'll just give it a couple more minutes and see if anyone else has anything they want to ask
Brilliant.
before we round off the session. Think that might be it for questions. Nothing else has come in through. Anyone? No? Right, like I said, we won't drag this out longer than it needs to be. Becky, I'll hand back over to you unless something else pops up in the Q&A.
Okay, brilliant. Well, yeah, I think that was it from me. Now that we've sort of gone through any questions, I don't have anything left to cover. So I think did we need to go through the feedback form?
Oh no, that will all that automatically populates after the session.
Brilliant. Well, yeah, well, unless anyone has anything else they want to add, anything they need to say, that's me done. Like I say, if you have any questions that come up again once we finish the webinar, always happy to answer those. So feel free to drop us a message and we can answer those separately. The website obviously has a lot of information and knowledge and stuff. So anything like any questions you might have, like they're probably answered in some kind of guidance or advice online. So yeah, so we've got lots of resources available and we're always happy to answer any questions and happy to help. But thank you very much for tuning in and listening to me.
Thanks, Becky. Also, just so people are aware, in the follow-up email, you'll also receive details of our copy advice team. We'll be able to offer you free confidential copy advice. So that's just another resource just to be aware of. Thanks, everyone. We'll be ending the session now.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.